If I understand this correctly, the reason they're not shifting is because their short-term gain for not doing is bigger than the long-term gain than for doing. Okay, yep. So that's the thing that you'll need to switch. Okay, this winds up being a twofold process, and like I said, there's nothing pleasant about any of this. Okay, you need to make sure that they have in their mind that there is a gain for doing what you're after. Okay, so one way or another, you need to articulate that for them. Now, the problem that you'll face when you're articulating that is the fact that they're just going to turn around to you and say, well, we don't want to do it. You know, I don't know quite how they'll say it, but the essence of it is, we don't want to do this because it's more comfortable to carry on the way that we are. Okay?
You know what the 100% pattern is, what language pattern, what you get, the problem is.
Yeah. Now, then, so the actual solution to that, okay, is to then actually ramp up the pain of not doing it. You know, it's like we were talking the other time. To shift people out of a stuck state, you need to give them away from drivers. Okay, towards stuff generally won't do it. The reason being is that if I oversimplify the world, the positive benefits of the towards stuff come after a time. The positives out of the negative gain tend to be immediate. You know, if I go, should I have a bowl of ice cream or should I go to the gym? The positive benefits of the gym thing is going to happen over time. The positive, you know, dopamine hit that you get from the bowl of ice cream happens right now. So it's short-term gains over long-term gains that's the issue. So you want to make sure that they know that there's positive gains for doing what you want them to do, because that's the only thing that's going to point them in the right direction. See, the trouble is when you hit people with negative motivation, you know, away from drivers, they could go anywhere. So you need to keep it in their mind that there is a good direction for them to go in. You know, because that points from there. But the reality of it is you need to make their lives really, really painful for not doing anything.
And that is the question, how to deal then with rapport?
Let me ask you outright. How do you define rapport? What is rapport to you?
Rapport is that I trust the guy I'm speaking to and that I believe that what he's telling me, there is a sense behind, and that it is the right thing to do, even when I'm in the first minutes or in the first thinking I have myself, that I have my doubts, but that I'm willed to think about the other options it can bring. And this willingness to think 360 degrees to see if there is this long-term beneficial gain when we go through the pain, this is not there. And this is thing because the rapport is a negative rapport that I say maybe I am part of the problem because I make the proposal as a person because of our history. And somebody else is doing it, maybe it is heard with other ears.
Yeah, okay. All right. Now, so do you get a sense that you're part of the problem?
I know because from the history, I drive a lot of changes and yes, we have these positive gains, but as you know, the reality is everybody has his own reality, and what is then coming out as a good thing of the actions are then contributed to others, but not to my person.
Yeah. Okay. That just sounds like organizations, really. If this winds up being a rapport issue, there's a couple of things that I'm going to suggest. The first is that rapport in its most traditional sense, you know, the way that most people see it, is not necessarily the issue here. Okay. My version of rapport really winds up being about responsiveness. Okay. Now,
what is your definition of responsiveness? Because I'm not a mother tongue, that I am on the right side of understanding.
Okay. Basically, my version of rapport with someone is I can predict their responses well enough for them to do what I want them to do.
Okay.
So if I oversimplify the world, and I'm not suggesting this is what you've got, but if I've got someone that actually is almost certainly going to do the opposite of anything that I ask them to do, then I'm going to ask them to do the opposite of what I want them to do. And that would be good enough for me in an organizational context. You know, the business about, I mean, I want respect, I want authority, I want liking, and I want all of those kind of things if I can get them. But actually, at the end of the day, a lot of the time, what I'm looking for is actually responsiveness. That's the first thing I kind of want to get to. So if I slip into jargon at the moment, what I think you've probably started off with is a whole bunch of negative anchors with them. Mm-hmm. Okay, so because of your history, there's an association that they've got that's whether they see you or when you discuss things with them or whatever the context is that you're in, they don't, you know, they turn off or they don't feel good or they just don't listen. Okay, so that's one thing that you need to deal with. Now, what we're looking to do is break their pattern of thoughts. Okay, so I kind of want you to spend a bit of time thinking about new or not necessarily new, but different ways of approaching them about this. Okay, again, if I oversimplify the world, in fact, I've got a mate that does this all the time. Okay? He's a bit of a techie, so he's not a real people person. Okay? And he literally drives all of his mates berserk because he only talks to people via text or email, you know. Mm. I mean, he obviously talks to people as friends and stuff, but if there's anything of any value to do, he will either send an email or a text message. And they wind up being very long, complicated kind of things. He was having a lot of problems with some people in his team about just, you know, they just weren't doing what he wanted them to do. They weren't reading the text messages. They weren't reading the emails and stuff. And to be honest, the solution, whilst it was uncomfortable for him, was actually really, really easy. He basically just had to come up and talk to them about it. So to keep him in his comfort zone, what I'd get him to do is write the email and then print it out, and instead of sending it to them, he would walk over there with it.
Okay.
You know, and a little bit more sophisticated than this, but basically he read it to them, which kind of kept him in his comfort zone, and the people he was talking to was just sort of like, oh, this is, you know, this is different enough for them to actually listen to him, you know. So whatever your channel of communication is with these guys, that's another possible route, is to actually change the medium. Okay. Another one linked to that would be to change the order and the sequence of what you say. So if you do I don't know, my traditional approach is to lead with benefits. So my conversation will go, here's the end result, and this is how good it is for you. Now that we've got that, let's work out how we're going to get there. Now, if I want to talk to someone, if I want to break that pattern, you know, if people have got too used to me using that position and it's causing a problem, then I might lead off with the problem and how big it is, you know, and drop them into that before we get into, you know, sort of this is how we're going to achieve stuff or this is the process of going in. And again, I'm oversimplifying, but I'm sort of saying, like, if you've got a traditional way of talking to them, that would be another way of breaking that pattern. Lead off with something else. So that's part of what you're going to do is actually, as best you can, wherever you can, break the pattern of behavior. Okay. The other part of that is potentially, do you speak to these people face to face? Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So I want you to, have you seen, trying to think of what it's called. There's a name for it, but I've forgotten what it is. So let me just explain what it is. So I'm sure you've heard this. It's about social status. Again, oversimplifying, I'm going to say like you can meet people as equals, okay? And you could be one above, you know, an authority figure, or you could be one below. So they're kind of like an authority figure to you. So if I go there, like you've got three states relative to the person that you're talking to. Mm-hmm. You can be one above, equally, you can be one below. Okay. Now, in each one of those positions, you can negotiate with that person. Okay. So, you know, if you were going to negotiate with them on equal terms, it's a collaborative thing. Okay. If you're going to negotiate from an authority position, it's going to be, you know, you probably wouldn't do this, but it's but in an oversimplified version, it's going to be you do what I want you to do for me. Yeah. If you're going to do it from a one below position, it's going to be, can you help me to get this done? Do you get it?
Yes.
So
a cooperative directing and asking.
Yeah, an acquiescent kind of approach. Okay, it's part. This is an adaptation of game theory. You know, adult parent child. That's more or less where this is coming from. So now, what happens with people is that they tend to be habitually in one mode with particular types of people. So. You might be collaborative with colleagues. You might acquiesce to, a partner. You might, you tend to slot into particular approaches. What I'm going to suggest is that you actually start thinking about what your approach to these people is and then switch it.
Okay.
You also possibly want to look at where they're coming from as well. Okay, so people's organizational power and their actual power or their perceived power can be wildly different, and you need to look at where they see their social standing. Okay, so again, oversimplifying, but this is one that happens to me quite a lot. If you find people that are, say, like traffic wardens, car park attendants, storemasters are good at this, that they often are little gods in their own environment. Okay? And the worst thing to do is to talk down to them, mm-hmm. you know. Best way of approaching them, given that kind of mindset would be to go, would be to very much go, I'm having a problem. I don't know how to do this. Can you help me? Is that, you know, reaffirms that.
Ask you for a favor.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So it's not that I'm expecting you to be authoritative over them. I'm just sort of going, well, look at how they see themselves. And if they take an authoritative position, then probably the best, with the best will in the world, you don't want to butt heads with them. That won't get them on board. Whereas something like acquiescing to them to get it done is probably a better approach. Does that kind of make sense?
Yeah, a lot of things. Because here I see that I tried over the last month or even years to be cooperative, because that I thought, only telling or even asking, both I did, and now I tried to give the ideas in the organization and see what they can make out of with their own drive. But in the end, the drive is missing, or their organizational direction is another one where they are not allowed to do this. This is absolutely true. And but maybe I have the director in my name. Maybe I have to direct a little bit more.
Yeah, well, you know, it's quite possibly the case. When people don't have a focus or a drive for themselves, they will look for a leader.
Yeah.
You know, and it's that's often quite a mistake that's made. And I used to do this a lot when I used to train trainers. Lots of trainers, including myself, actually, tend to want to be facilitative in a classroom environment. So true trainers aren't interested in actually pushing knowledge onto people. They actually want people to, generally, they want people to explore it and develop it and you know, sort of find ways of using whatever that knowledge is. So they tend to want to facilitate, which is great when you've got a collaborative class. When they don't have any interest, you actually do have to lead them.
Yeah.
And the other thing, this is real pure kind of like sales tactics, okay? But I don't know whether this is actually going to be appropriate. But let me float it out there. What I kind of want you to get to is to find out what's actually fundamentally important to them. Ideally, you really want it around values.
Okay. Yeah.
That's kind of, you know, those large abstract terms that you can get, if you can get it out of them. Right? The reason I'm saying that this might not be appropriate is because actually you're trying to do it to a group of people, not individuals. Okay, so it might not necessarily be as easy to isolate. The best way of doing this sort of stuff, if it was your own team, you wouldn't have a problem with this, because if you've been in any in different teams doing the same kind of task, you already know that they all have a flavour or character of themselves. You know, that particular group of people at that particular time, that it takes on its own character, and you can elicit those values. You just have to ask them, you know, sort of, as a team, who are we? What's important to us? What we're doing? You know, the sort of thing. Yeah. If you can do this with these guys, that's great. You know, if you can't, I think the best way to approach that would be to get as much information out of them as you can as individuals, and then hypothesize, you know, take your best guess what's important for them as a team. Now, depending on whether you're using towards or away from motivation, you're either going to link that to what you want them to do, or you're going to really well and truly trash it over what they're doing at the moment.
Trash it.
Okay, so they're a team of planners.
Okay.
Right. So let's say what's important to them is, I don't know, having a cohesive plan.
Mm-hmm.
Right. It's just for argument's sake. Okay. What you really want to do is go, how could you have a cohesive plan if you haven't built this into it?
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Do you get the idea?
Questioning the baseline of their thinking.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. And you really want to nail it, you know, so, basically, what they're in a stuck state. What you really, really want to do is go, this stuck state is in complete violation of your values. Yeah. Whatever it is you believe about yourself cannot be true if you're behaving like this. Mm-hmm. That's the pattern. Yeah.
Yeah.
I focused on the negative end of that there. The positive end of it works more or less as powerfully, actually. If you can turn around and go, you know, if this is what your identity is, you will be so much more of it if you do what I ask you to do.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that works just as well. I'm trying to think of what else might be there. Tell me more. Actually, let me ask you a slightly different question. Is this the stuff that you're looking for?
Yeah, that is absolutely cool because it gives me really, I have for me now here 6 key points where I can do something different than what I did in the last weeks, months. Even for my thinking, have another way to see my activities. And that is really, again, a lot of value for me. It's great.
Good.
Yeah.